Hello and a very warm welcome to Public Forum. I'm Amandra Bhatt. Today we talk about state of the Indian economy. And to talk about the state of the Indian economy, we have with us in the studios an eminent panel. Please welcome Dr. Rakesh Mohan Joshi. He is a professor and chairperson at the International Collaboration and Research at the Indian Institute of Foreign Trade. Welcome to the program, Dr. Joshi. Sitting next to him is Dr. Amirullah Khan. He's an economist, president of the Global University. Welcome to the program, Dr. Khan. We are also joined by Annapurna Singh, senior journalist. She's a special correspondent with the Deccan Herald. Welcome to the program, Annapurna Singh. Let me begin with you, Dr. Joshi. 2015 has just gone by. How do you review this particular year insofar as the Indian economy is concerned?
The last year, it seems, have been a very mixed one. Wherein one thing which I think that India performed better is we performed better in terms of the GDP growth. Mm-hmm. You know, our GDP has been somewhere between 7.2-7.3 compared to wherein, you know, among the largest economies, our GDP growth has been very good. If you see that, you know, the core competence also we have improved in terms of, you know, the global competitiveness index, you know, from 71 we went to 55. So I think some of the structural reforms we increased, in ease of doing business also we improved, you know, from 142 we have gone to 130. So certain improvement has certainly taken place. But you know, the problem also remains. But you have seen, like, in the external sector, as far as, you know, in the last 12 months, there has been now a continuous fall in export. Export, you have seen almost last month, it has been, you know, in November, it has been 24, you know, more than 24% fall in terms of that export, which is, I think, a cause of concern. And therefore, these economic reforms need to reflect in terms of our external sector. One thing is being said, even the imports are declining. Import declining could be good, but other thing is declining import is also indicative of the low domestic activity. So I think it's a matter of concern. So, you know, I will be able to say that in time to come, I think we need to be very cautious in terms of our policies, so that I think, you know, whatever the reforms and the measures that the government takes, you know, it seems like in export, you can, you know, attribute to the decline in export to the external conditions or oil fall. But it is then, you know, the government measures also need to reflect, you know, some impact on that. And therefore, our downfall in export is much, much higher compared to the downfall in the global export. So I think it's a matter of concern.
Okay, Mr. Joshi, as Annapurna Singh just said, that these numbers, they have to be sustainable, be it, you know, the FDI numbers or the growth numbers. And the performance of the farming sector, it seems, is holding the country back from, you know, achieving the kind of growth that is needed in the medium term to be able to actually outpace China.
No, I think you are very right. As far as the to have the growth, the number is to be sustainable, and I think the history is very clear that prior to 1991, India's per capita income was much more than China. Indian economy prior to 1980 was much above China. The problem started only later, because they grew later. India today is $2 trillion economy. China today is somewhere between $10.5 trillion economy, five times more. China over the last, after 1990, China has become almost five times richer than India. So if you say you are growing and someone else is growing much above, so I think it's a matter of concern. If you see, you know, she was very right to say the petroleum prices, you know, from 120, $130 US dollar per barrel has come to 40 and now 36. From 36, it is also said it can go even further down.
Never in the history of five never in the history this has happened.
India, it is extremely important, because 80-85% of our requirement we import. India's trade deficit otherwise, you know, India has got 140-150 billion dollars of trade deficit. Major trade deficit on account of oil. Oil prices going down. So I think this is probably the time for government to take bold step.
Okay.
Because bold step you can take.
What kind of steps are you pointing to?
No, I think any bold step can be taken. The bold step includes, you know, especially in the agriculture sector. Agriculture in this country is very different than agriculture in America. In India, 60 to 70% of the population is dependent on agriculture. Nowhere else on the world, except for some, you know, especially in the countries like, you know, the in the big economy. And in case the growth is not coming from agriculture, and if the entire growth is coming only from the services and the few services sector, so I think it would have a long-term repercussions, because you will not be able to sustain that growth in time to come. As far as the manufacturing sector, what he was saying, India's share in the world manufacturing sector is somewhere between 1.9% or so.
But that's the only sector that seems to have, besides services, performed, you know, fairly well.
I think manufacturing sector, you start with a low base in manufacturing. Your share in the world, manufacturing in the world is about 1.9% at the most. But in China, China's share in the world manufacturing is 17%, 18%. Now, India's consumption in the manufacturing sector is almost 4 to 5%. Now, under no circumstance will be able to retain your trade deficit also because of this. Because small things you are importing. If you see the data minutely, you find the consumer electronics production in the last 4 years, rather than increasing, it has gone down. So I think if you carry out the micro analysis, you will also reach to the micro problem. And therefore, what is very important is government need to focus, you know, sector specific measures for these sectors. So manufacturing is one, and agriculture is another. And then growth should also come with increase in employment, which is also not showing.
Right. Put that to Dr. Joshi. Did we take the easy way out? Because we did, as you mentioned, have a windfall in the form of a fall in global crude oil prices, didn't we?
No, absolutely. I think we have not taken the opportunity. Because, you know, it was an unprecedented fall which has happened in the global crude oil files. And I think this fall in crude oil prices was with the grace of God. It was not effort of any government, any economist, any analyst. And those who understand commodity market, nobody can predict that. Nobody predicted that. Now, you know, United States is the biggest producer of the crude oil rather than Saudi Arabia. Nobody thought 6 years before. So this is unprecedented situation which has come in favor of India. In favor of India. Because, if you see 10 years before, our dependence on imported oil, which was 70%, has grown to 80% now. Our dependence on imported oil is growing because we cannot generate it. The problem now is coming is, I think there is a great flexibility which is given at this time. Now it is estimated that the petrol price will fall, is likely to fall in near future, but nobody can predict that with certainty. It may increase it, nobody knows it. It can increase it. And therefore, I think there is no time than right now for government to act on this.
The other thing
he has been saying is that, you know, even the taxes are being increased, the excise is being increased for so many times. So even the benefit is not passed in proportion to the fall in the prices of the petroleum. What's happening is, one thing is the FDI, the government has really done a commendable work. You have seen in terms, I think our Prime Minister has been the biggest marketer for the country. He has gone around and tried to, take every opportunity during his trip for inward investment in India. You have seen, I think, the recent Japanese Prime Minister's visit. Japan, as you are aware of, is, almost the economy is having a negative or, you know, very minimal growth rate. Wherein Brazil is having -3% growth and Russia had 3% growth. Now, if you see the Japan's this thing, Japan very recently, last month, it has just, escaped, slipping into a depression, recessionist economy. Now, what has happened is, and therefore it's extremely important, and you know, the Prime Minister is very wise to get those steps, to get the Japanese investment in India. You have seen that 98,000 crores of that, you know, the bullet train and a lot of investment coming from Japan. You have seen the similarly, the, you know, we are getting the FDA in India, which I think over the last months have certainly improved. And because of, some of the structural, initiatives, the one I think which has happened is the Made in India campaign. Made in India is one campaign, and more is marketing of Made in India. So I think the people in other parts of the countries or the foreign countries have started thinking. Say, I was talking to some German corporates a few days back. Now, Germany basically, you know, in terms of precise equipment and manufacturing, they have got an ace. India, the biggest problem in our manufacturing sector is lack of technology, lack of innovation, lack of indigenous patents. And therefore, we do need investment from foreign countries. And I think the environment in these countries for investment in India is upbeat. You have seen the Prime Minister's recent visit to Russia, who has also, you know, agreed or accepted to manufacture some high-tech defense equipment in this country. As far as defense is concerned, you are aware India is the largest importer of defense equipment. And we are so largest that, you know, taking together the second and third, we import more. So I think there has been a positive, you know, outlook in terms of the investment. But something which has not happened is, again, you see, Mauritius has been our largest FDI partner for over a long period of time. If you see last, you know, 15 years, almost 38-40% of our investment came only from Mauritius.
So that's our own money coming back to us.
Singapore was another largest. What happened is, because India, you know, tightened Mauritius in the last 6, 7, 8 months, now Singapore's share in FDI in India is 22%. So if you analyze that, you find almost 60-65% money is rooted either through Singapore, Mauritius, or a few tax havens. So it is our own money which is rooted. So I think this FDI data you also need to analyze very cautiously. So you are aware that, you know, you are talking of bringing in FDI. You have seen in the past 1 year, Indian companies are going out. You have seen the Grofer or Snapdeal. You know, the Indian companies have gone out and they have established their base to Singapore. In terms of ease of doing business, you know, India stands at 130, Singapore stands at 1 for last 10 years. So I think there is enough time for us to introspect. You have seen FDI in retail, we debated so much on this channel and a number of channels. You opened it up, but did you buy any product in last 2 years from any of the multi-brand retailers? Kabhi aapne, did you ever bought from Walmart or Kafu? How many of the Indians have bought? Because they have not come. The law says they can come, but they are not coming. So it is not the law, you need to implement the law. The whole package, because there are certain things which is preventing the foreign firms to come in India. And I think you need to also ask the Indian firms why they are shifting their base to Singapore.
But then and what about, you know, the government's focus on improving the ease of doing business?
No, government focus is there and this has increased. You are aware that from 142 we have come to 130. But if you do a critical analysis into that, the improvement has happened only in 2-3 things. Improvement is only of 0.1%. With this 0.1%, you know, your ranking goes to almost, you know, 12 ranks or so. Also, the ease of doing business with the World Bank and, you know, they have also got it done statewide. Where states are also ranked. So I think it's a very positive, you know, sign of the government. The state's involvement in this government is, I think, unprecedented.
Absolutely. Dr. Joshi, I'll continue with you. Let's focus now on the farm sector. You know, the one sector where the challenges are manifold. There are a lot of concern, as expressed by you and your co-panelist earlier. The farm sector seems to be in a state of distress, although the government is positive that agriculture is on the road to, you know, being on the 4% growth rate. What prospects do you see here? Where do we stand today?
You know, farm sector is extremely important for any government in the center and the state government, irrespective of their political ideology. Because 60-65% of people in this country are still, you know, dependent for their livelihood on the farm sector. The other thing is, this is a sector which has, you know, which is unlike the Europe and America, wherein farming is a business. In India, it's a livelihood. Now, the one is, at the international forum, the farming across, they do not recognize that you know, the India, the farming sector is very different. The Indian farming sector, you are aware of, that, you know, over the years, if you see the individual data, you find our import dependence is slowly but steadily increasing even for the food grade. Now, so far, one is, you know, the India, rather than exporting those farm things, our dependence is increasing. You have seen that there has been, you know, little increase in terms of the acreage of the land. There has been very marginal increase in terms of the productivity is concerned. And therefore, in case there is neither, whereas our population is growing up, you know, at a much greater pace than the farm sector can cope up with. Therefore, farming reforms are extremely important not only for your GDP growth rate, but sustainability and food security in this country.
Right.
Two things have to happen. Productivity has to go up. And other thing is, then farmers have to be made these inputs and, know-how available to them. And farmers in this country also need to be protected against international legislations or international strictures which are, negotiated at the international forum. It is extremely important. It is extremely important for any government to protect the farm sector and to improve the productivity. If you see, say small sector in China and India, the difference in productivity is multifold. India, despite being the largest producer of milk in the world, we are not a player in the international market. Rather, our dependence on import increases. India, another problem is you talk of availability, but there is a hidden hunger in this country, wherein the people who get even the food suboptimal level feed. And therefore, I think the government what need to do is one is the farmers have to be subsidized, increasing the productivity, and the research, the output of the research need to go into that. And the agriculture, another thing is the processing. You have seen that when the FDI in retail, the debate was there, it was said once that FDI comes, all problem of the processing. You are aware that 25% to 40% of the horticulture and the vegetables products goes wasted. We have no facility. And even today, the problem of processing, the problem of transportation from farm to fork prevail. So I think the situation, you have seen this season, there was a glut in the milk production in this country. Except for cooperatives, we could not get that milk. If you are not getting the milk, the farmers had to make a distress sell. And you are going to see in the next season, wherein, people will be, desensitized to produce the milk. And milk is a commodity. In case a cattle or an animal cannot produce the milk, the cattle goes for a slaughterhouse. And then even the good quality cattle goes to a slaughterhouse, especially from the bigger cities, you will not have even milk. So I think rather than exporting, I think the strategist will be required to have a strategy for importing not only milk, but even the farm product. So I think it's extremely important. And India being a player in the market
better
for any food
management.
Any food product, India being in the market, the prices of these, the commodities, the food commodities, India has got a capacity to fluctuate those prices. And therefore, India's security is extremely important, and government has to do these steps at the, immediate. You are aware that, it's a great opportunity also. Why opportunity? Because petroleum prices are low. Petroleum prices are low, it contributes to lower fertilizer prices. It contributes to lower energy for the farm sector. And I think there it's the most appropriate time that we need to do it right now. Harvesting, the irrigation practices have to improve. Now, irrigation practices is, I think for perpetually we cannot telling every time that we are dependent on rain. How long we'll be dependent on rain?
Right, Dr. Joshi, we've reached the end of the program, but as admitted by all of you, there is absolutely no alternative to agricultural growth. Perhaps on that note, it's time for me to wrap up this discussion here. I